Hello, hello. Hello, hello. Hello, hello.
My job is very easy, and I can acquire some of the information here and there. And also, the organizers asked me to, because I don't want to stand between your lunch and myself, I will be cutting short my lecture to half an hour. Or even slightly. So that I touch only points which are not touched by Mr. Gupta. And I'm a local guy, so I will be available at any time. So we can discuss another one. I'm here. I think we have to stand for enrollment. And so I can discuss and all. I'll just give you some points. Innovative technologies, what we can introduce in the water and wastewater treatment, and where we can also take up research, and so that we can develop a more facile, cost effective, more efficient treatment system, which here will be presented. So this report is a very old slide in 2009 report. So, the water generated, wastewater generated, earlier that was reported 22,000 and then down to 38,000 MID and treated after the same cost, which is only 11,000 MID. So only the, my own industry should show that since a large and treated sewage gas problem for the environment, which is again affecting the groundwater and also surface water quality, leading to number of diseases, all these things you have there. So, there is a great necessity to develop more efficient process to treatments. And so, as our example has said, instead of going for a massive, large scale treatment systems handled by municipality, it is better to go for modular systems. Catering to the small units like a university or some housing colony, so that it can take care of its water and management and get treated. So for these, developing this kind of modular treatment systems, you need some innovation, and these are the areas you can innovate and make it possible to just as mentioned here. So these are all the normal, routine, regular treatment systems for surface water. We have a number of units like storage, disinfection, and filtration, and so then the chlorine treatment, and all these things are there. All of you are aware of these things. And wherever possible, these require a large area and a large establishment, so you have to really treat 100 MID or something like that. So these can be improved if you have some innovation and can go for a rather modular systems. So similarly, the convention wastewater treatment system, all of you are aware, and where you have big chamber and a sedimentation tank, and then goes to the biological treatment. Some of the municipalities, including Hyderabad, so the waste treatment, municipal waste treatment stopped at the second sedimentation tank on. After sedimentation, they are letting into the to the Musi River or something like that. And that's why though we have a very good capacity to treat, it was not fully in operation. And most of the things that the municipal sewage collected will after sedimentation tank is sent back to the surface water or the groundwater. Similarly, this is for industrial waste and where industrial waste and waste are mixed and then the evaporation tank and then of mineralization sent to the biological system at which first treatment and where a number of metal colonies are coming. And finally, there will be a biological threat for treated water which is being sent. And here also, a huge number of technologies are coming and making the process more cost effective and more. So then, in these systems, the nanotechnology plays a very important role to make the process more cost effective, more efficient, and you can go for a modular system. So the applying the nanotechnology, using nanotechnology in various processes, you can go for a modular, more efficient system where the large infrastructure is not be gone, you not spend money. And so at nanoscale, so many materials offer large surface area, and also the various, you can also the surface of the nanomaterial can either modulate or mediate. Make it functional with the different functional agents so that they to tailor-made them to put attain certain properties. So the application of nanotechnology has come largely in a number of water wastewater treatments, and because of the smoothly scalable size, different properties like high surface area, fast resolution, high reactivity, strong absorption, discontinuous properties such as super paramagnetism, quantum effects. I just mentioned where these can be used, and these are the areas where research can also be taken up. I think already some aspects that Indian group have been taken there, but I just will mention here how it is attractive for a laboratory scale study and functions can be taken up. In fact, this is a because of this huge volume of municipal sewage and industrial waste coming and dealing with a large infrastructure, collecting the whole thing in a one place, better to go for a modular system so that the problem can be tackled in a decentralized way. And there are more highly efficient technologies can be brought. So of course I don't know whether you are able to be visible or not. So this the nanotechnologies are useful in absorption, where we have a huge number of filtration units. The absorption of various novel nanomaterials, both the engineering operations aside, and also very cost effective, very efficient. And I just mentioned area is the way we are all working is magnetic nanomagnetic compounds. The nanomagnetic compounds like ferrofluids or any supermagnetic copper or cobalt or nickel magnetic compounds you can prepare, these have a large surface area. You can also tailor make the surface to see that a particular pollution is absorbed more effectively. And particularly why I'm telling you the magnetic moment, what to say, you can rather modify this. Yeah. So these, that is a core structure of the nanomaterial, nanomagnetic material, where you can, the surface can be coated with a suitable absorbing substance, substance which can bond with the target pollutants and then make it a good adsorbent, highly efficient adsorbent, suitable for a removal of pollutants like arsenic, color, or hazardous organics. This is a really tremendous facility in engineering operation. Adsorption normally, when you are scaling out in a high scale, large scale, the problems you meet with the carbon, there is normally acrylic carbon is used as adsorbent for removal of many pollutants in industries. And the activated carbon problem is the clogging. So when you go remove the pollutant from a gravitation pump, so after some time, whole that will be clogged, and you have to reactivate, remove it, and deactivate it. And second thing is because the density of the activated carbon is not very high compared to water, so sometimes it is very difficult to separate water from the actual carbon, and a lot of you have to go for drying and all. Then you use a magnetic absorb. You can also attach a magnetic compound, electromagnetic compound like iron or a copper to activate calcium by a surface modification. So you can get an activated carbon attached with a magnetic adsorbent. So because it is all nano inside, huge surface area, they are more efficient. Sometimes the efficiency of absorbing capacity of activated carbon is increased 100 times. Second thing is, when the reactor is dealing with the 1 ton or 100 kilograms of adsorbent, when the clogging, meaning extra magnetic field, the adsorbent can be mixed or stirred. It is that the crossing problem is not there, so the operation will be good. Second thing, so to remove the adsorbent from water is very easy, again using simple adsorbent. Magnetic, extra magnetic field. So these are the really huge advantages of the magnetic adsorbents, nano-magnetic adsorbents. So you can attach these nano-magnetic adsorbents to regular adsorption system, like activated carbon, make a composite adsorbent and try for a removal of number of pollutants, hazardous organic. For example, carbon removal is a very big problem in industry, and so these find very interesting application. I feel some of these are not very difficult to prepare in an average laboratory like or a modest laboratory like KMU, so that you can easily, by any method, you can prepare the magnetic compounds, and these are not very well explored. I tell you one gigantic problem: the oil spill. Oil spill is a very big problem when a ship crashes or something, oil leaks from a big oil refinery. The whole water will be spread with the oil. And with that, the aquatic life in the water system loses contact with oxygen, so they will die. So removal of the water spill is a very big problem, and not only absorbing or using a separate collecting and holding, it's a big, engineeringly big problem. So if you can a ferromagnetic fluid, like any ferromagnetic fluid, on this oil spill, the oil, the magnetic compounds will be spread uniformly, and applying an external magnetic field, you can collect the entire oil spill. Very easy. Very easy to operate. So like that, you can make the system very cost effective, very easy. You are not adding any additional pollutant. You are not just, you can remove entirely by external magnetic field removal. Like that, number of programs with adsorbents you can generate and study, and the efficiency of removing a number of pollutants. This is one area I feel that the Vindhwan group should take the initiative. And coming to the membranes, and Dr. Sengupta already referred that R-Well is one of the important technology for desalination, removal of getting the pure water for drinking standards, and all that. And the main barrier in this is getting a highly efficient membrane which can pass through a huge dissolved solids and also can retain them, and it can be regenerated. So these are the problems. And a number of companies already have started huge investment. Like in Bangalore, they have started a nano membrane production for desalination and all that. And this is one of the important areas where a lot of innovation is required. And you can also start work on this area where it is not a difficult research. You can, if you have an electroscan film making machine which costs between 6 to 12 lakhs, you can fabricate nanofibers and using a number of polymers and which will dissolve in a area, you take those precursors in a solvent, and then mix a nano salt of aluminum oxide or titanium dioxide or any other oxide, metal oxide, which has a capacity to absorb many of these hydroxide metals. These can absorb a number of metals in the organic, but if you prepare a nanostructure for them in a solid form and mix in these polymers, polyethylene, polycarbonate, all these their precursors to take and pass through the electroprocessing setup. And so then you can prepare different types of membranes and which have special specific absorption or removal capacity. And this is one area I think the JNU environment group should take interest, and is not very difficult to establish, and they have a number of World Bank programs, and they can easily purchase the Galactose building setup and prepare a number of membranes and test their ability, efficiency, and compare with the existing one whether they are variable in the cost of one or other. So this is some area where we are taking up in KLU direction. So we are preparing going for a system for 100 liter per hour system, both for a modular level and also as a part of the Argo, where we are incorporating the nanofibers. We are producing nanofibers using polyethylene and mixing with a nano materials like aluminum oxide, titanium oxide, zirconium oxide, and this we are using testing variability as a part of a modular one. And so it is a nano composite that is with a halo fiber, the air-free membrane modules we are preparing and testing for the efficiency of. This is not a single man job. Many institutes have to work, and a number of innovative methods we can develop, pass them into and try for the removal of the pollutants, particularly in the groundwater. What are the pollutants? Many areas are served by groundwater for drinking, and you can give a modular system for the village. For the removing of some of these pollutants. You know, organic pollutants you can remove, inorganic metal pollutants you can remove. So this is where you need people, and people like you can start work and create innovation and give a breakthrough in the technology. Similarly, for Argo, we want to go for an analogy, right, and a thin film nanocomposite membrane. And these membranes will be spiral wound films will prepare and test as a part of the Argo, how it works, how efficiently it works. That means based on the depending upon the pollutant you have to address in the groundwater, you can tailor make these modules and see that it will get a very cool to drinking water. These programs we are taking in collaboration with IACG. And so this, in fact, we have submitted a recent proposal to DST under water technology program to an integrated system. So this one part, and there is another part is, for example, there you have a microbial fuel cell which will use the sewage water into production of electricity and also treatment. The microbial, these organic waste will be degraded by the microbial organisms, and in this process the electron is released, that electron is taken into the power, and the power system will take care of the running of the entire system, and then the outlet is still will have some non-degradable organic compounds which will send to the biomethanation system where water power will be generated, and that also you have these modular membrane systems in Argo for production of pure water. So you will have a power generation and also the biogas generation and also the fuel water generation, an integrated system. We have proposed at 100 liters per hour module, which if we are successful, we want to go first there. Recently, we have received a grant from Indo-US program, and myself along with IACP people have taken from our US ambassador, Richard Varma, and the NRE secretary, is under his setup, regional program. And even Jane can also apply, as Jane Booker said. So every system, you can go for a modular one addressing a local area problem, so that will solve a major problem in water and wastewater treatment. So here, in the base sector, what we got around 2 crores for that, and where we'll tackle our KNU wastewater generated, treat it, that is for our hospitals and all that, we'll get around 5 tons of kitchen waste and per day, and this kitchen waste will use production of biomethane, methanation production of gas, and this gas will be converted into fuel, and also 2 cylinders per day of gas for our again for the kitchen back, and again 5,000 liters of fertilizer, liquid fertilizer, biofertilizer, which can be used for growing our gardens, or you can sell it off. So that is the things we have commercially worked out and shown is a commercially viable program. And the Indo-US program gives 2 crores for a 5 ton and another 30 to 40 lakhs the university has to spend. For civil construction, the university has to spend. And the technology they will implement, IACD is implementing the technology, we are implementing it. And 2 years, the consortium will operate and show, they will give 300 kilowatt energy, kilowatt-hours energy per day to the university, to the power grid, 2 cylinders per day to the kitchen, and 5,000 liters of open later. But we have, after 2 years, the university has to take full responsibility for maintaining and operation. So that is the thing. And we have got the award, the first award. The second phase also ready now open. KNU interested can apply for this, can take care of, because number of hospitals are there, can take care of, treatment of its own today, and produce clean water, and produce power, 2 gas cylinders, which is 5 tons, to the kitchen every day, 300 kilowatt hours of power, for, if it is for a 5 ton capacity. So one thing is, JNU has to give only half acre of land and rather spend 30 to 40 lakhs initially for civil works, and rest of things they will do and maintain CT, and monitoring also will be done by the company. So this kind of schemes, because university being a model, so it should establish this kind of working models so that people can learn this is something working commercially good, and so that other institutes or nearby localities can adopt that thing. So another important thing is, so the antimicrobial activity, the, for example, you have to chlorinate your drinking water and with anti, for making it biologically enabled for drinking, so drinking standards. So there are a number of nano materials like nano LD, nano DAO, nano DLMO, nano magnesium oxide, and nano CO4. All these have a different mechanism to kill the microorganisms and keep the water safe for drinking. And sometimes the antimicrobial agent which you are using, these chlorination, all that, they have some residues, and which was proved also, some of these secondary residues generated from chlorine, all they are carcinogenic. And if you go for these nano materials, there is not any such problem. Residues are very, very low, and you can easily remove. And there is no, and the metabolism also, you can on demand microwave control nanotechnology. So you can encapsulate these anti-microbial nano material in a shell, and which has a sensitivity for the microorganism. So if there is a microorganism, the gate will open, the material will come in. And so on demand, when there is a university, the nanomaterial will come and kill the bacteria. So that do not overload the system and no residues will be there. So these are the new technologies that are coming. Young brains like you have to take up. These are all highly socially relevant and take up, and they are not very high-end technology programs. You can, the laboratories, what equipment you have, I know, these can be easily taken up in these laboratories and only on direction that is there. So I will just tell you, I don't want to give a routine thing. We already and exhaustively, all the problems, issues were dealt by Sen Gupta. Just my interest is only to inspire some students to take up some innovative research areas in water and wastewater treatment. I'm just giving an example. I think in 1993, we got a project on nanocarbon production in the interview and by flame senses. And when the program was submitted, though it was recommended, some experts commented the NAMDQ is a new one. And the myself is also new for this nanotechnology. How can they do it all? Later, we put different equipment, we got it. And to my surprise, 5 students got their PhD, and that laboratory production of the flame sensors of nanocarbon is still working, it's still going on. So there I say, the strength is students. Once you give a direction to the student, the facility to the student, doing the working. And they produce results more than what they expect. So that's why all of you try to understand the various opportunities available and issues that need to be addressed more urgently than other things and try to address. And so these are regarding the water treatment for the industrial waste, where you have a biorefractory materials, pollutants, which are not amenable for biodegradation, you have to go for some physical methods where you have use of innovation in reducing them or degrading them by physical methods and or chemical methods. So in this, you use advanced oxidation methods, where we produce hydroxyl nitrogen, which is a powerful oxidation power, 2.3 and 2.2. So all other, compared to all other oxidizing agents, the hydroxyl nitrogen will produce, and the will be now is a commercially viable technology, and there is a possibility of a lot of innovation and improvement of this technology. And so these are the various routes through which hydroxide radical is produced. Hydrogen peroxide, that is the microbial fermentation, and phantom photophantom reaction, UV radiation. These are discussed some of them, where you can also show innovation. So these are all the various mixers which are used for production of hydroxyl radical. Again, you can improve the efficiency or these things using the nano materials, because they offer higher oxidation potential and also the large area, like for example solar. If you want to use the solar photocatalytic reactions, so the titanium dioxide is a semiconductor material, it releases electron when you bombard with the light, and the wavelength absorption radius is very narrow, and so you have to use a particular type of UV radiation to produce the electron, and that electron oxidizes the water into the hydroxyl radical. So these are the UV ozone process where the hydroxides are released, and if you want to make them photochemical, so you have to use a, for example, say 200 to 280 nanometers UV light you have to use, but by there is a very small spectrum in the solar light. By using a soap, a number of coatings, nano coatings, like graphene oxide coatings, you can increase this rather adsorption capacity, increase this range to large area and make it more effective. That's why so the solar photocatalytic reactions can be made more effective and efficient with using a nano coatings like graphene oxide and titanium dioxide. So these are all the processes and where here also that if you go for a nano bubbling and technologies, so the nano bubbles instead of normal micro bubbles is offer a larger area for reaction surface and go for a high efficient reaction. So these all these efficiency can be increased. Just I want to do this. Yeah. So the ultrasonication is a technique, is a you need not add anything, and using sonication that Bindu and group has already done some published some work. But using the ultrasonication, the beauty of this is at the micro bubble, you get a 5000 Kelvin temperature, though the bulk temperature remains at 30 or 40 degrees. So that is the thing. So because of 5000 Kelvin at that nano bubble produced at the radiation, so the many organic compounds decompose easily when compared to the normal heating or something like that. So the ultrasonic further, you are not adding anything physically. You are adding only the light. And so there is no pollutant you are adding. So it becomes a clean technology. And you can also make a pulse plasma, high voltage discharge through water, and also hydrodynamic calibration. All these technologies, a lot of innovation you can study or create and identify design, or even using a number of nano materials. So this is a fabrication process, where the micro sorting produces the ultrasonic waves, and where the material, the pollutants in the water decompose. So there is no residual products, and the process can be much more simple, and produce a new ultimate disposal of technology for generation. So zero waste, you can also think for this. So EV process is an electron beam process. This is in practice in Japan and Korea because it's highly energy intensive process. And in fact, we thought of, I am here in 2003, I think, ITC Bhattacharya approached us because they will be releasing huge color. Whatever treatment they do for the color removal, still there is some color which many physical methods fail. They can't work beyond acceptable concentration. So they asked that because there is a public interest litigation, they are throwing all their treated effluent to the Godavari River, and still the color persistent is there, and people have complained that they are releasing the colored effluents into the Godavari. So they asked us, what are the costs? Can you remove the clean anti-hair color? Then we, along with the BART, developed a program for e-beam, but it's not, this is very not a cost-effective program, but you'll get a clean water. And they said, okay, can you demonstrate for 1 cubic meter? And then we tried to estimate the cost of that is around 1 crore, they have agreed, and the BART also, because BART is also already working using beta rays, gamma rays, the treatment of astral radiation in Mumbai. So they are using, bombarding the, all the hazardous organ astral rays, because the beta rays and gamma rays are coming as a waste product in bar. So they used to create a reactor where these astral rays are going there, and they should treat that, and then finally turn to result in yard after they become sick. Here, the emin, electron beam, generated, will burn everything in carbon dioxide, in organic. Of course, not suitable for inorganic, only for organic, and simply you get carbon dioxide. And this program is not pH sensitive, it can work in 3 to 11 pH. It is technically much more simple, alternative to color and suspended solids. And this process, a new ultimate disposal technology. And so this is a laboratory module. So where one thing is you need a vacuum, and also with the electron beam cannot sustain ambient atmosphere. You have to keep a complete structure. So all the waste you have to circulate. The number of units and the electron beam will be hitting, and the treated water will be coming. So this is a technology, clean technology, no doubt, is not cost effective. But then the impact of the pollutants released in the environment are more dangerous than the what you are expecting. So that's such a kind of cost technology. You have to get it done at any cost, you have to adopt such technologies. So this is an easy process. This is being implemented for municipal waste sewage treatment in Japan. There are a number of cities where they have installed this, because there is a power is not a problem for them. They have a nuclear reactors using nuclear power supply. So there they are using this technology. Even Korea they are using. Cities in India is not in practice. But at that time, so when I am here, the most of the pharmaceutical industries, they waste hazardous waste generation in some small units becoming a big problem. And then we have contemplated for creating small, highly hazardous waste effluents, can we implement this kind of technology to cover at that time. Of course, I'm talking about photocatalysis also. So this photocatalysis, we use a semiconductor like titanium dioxide, where you have a valency bond and bond, and the electron will be excited from a lower level to higher level, and that electron will react with the materials like the oxygen and produce a super radical, and which reacts with water to produce a dissolved oxygen and hydroxyl radical. And so this hydroxyl radical you can use for any oxidation of any organic material. So this if you can do it using solar light, the technology is coming. Now it is available in a number of countries. But the main problem is this titanium dioxide absorbs only in small range, the solar radiation. So you have to, if you can coat this titanium dioxide with a special nano composition. So these are the various technologies. Some of the papers published here on waste, water waste pollution. And so these are some of the areas I want to touch. I can do it at some other point, because we are already delayed for lunch. And I only wish some of you can take up some of these areas, but in your research, there is a lot of elevation possible, and really help this session. And once again, I thank the promise of our memorial trust for doing this opportunity. And thank them, and also to all of us, and I'll be happy to.